Okay, so we will start a new semester on Fusion category. So this is the third semester on Fusion category. So for people who are not yet in the WeChat group, please scan this QR code. Scan this QR code to be in the WeChat group. So as I said, this is the third semester about Fusion category, but maybe some of them did not attend it. The two last semester. So I will first read here. This is a slide of last semester. And I will very quickly read this slide to recover the basis. And after that, we will start new material. But I will take few sessions to read the last semester slides. So so I will be quick. So if So if so can you hear me or not? Tu m'entends? Mec écrit en chinois. Problème de lui, c'est sûr. Ok. So I will cover very quickly. I will read very quickly this slide of last semester. So if you want to go more into the details about that, you should watch the video of last semester, which are in the web page of last semester course, and also the previous semester also. Okay. So I hope everybody can hear. No. Yeah. Okay. 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 So, as usual, so this course covers a book by Ettinghoff, Gelacky, and Nikshish Ostrick. This book called Tensor Category, so by this guy. Okay, so this is okay. Then, so what should I say? So of course, if you have question, please ask question on the WeChat group or on the Zoom, or you can ask now, you can ask between two courses, etc. There is no problem. So this course, I will put at the end of the course, I will put the slide on the WeChat group, also the link to the video recording. And I will also put the video on my YouTube channel. Okay. Okay. So, few motivation. What about a category? So the category theory is some sense a categorification of some notion coming from algebra. So set corresponds to category. Abelian group to abelian category, monoid to monoidal category, commutative monoid to braided monoidal category, fusion ring to fusion category. So in this course will be mainly about fusion category. So let me explain briefly what is a fusion ring. So from a purely combinatorial point of view, A fusion ring can be understood as just a finite set with some fusion rules between the elements of this finite set with some non-negative coefficient. So you have that. And this rule should satisfy some axiom. And this axiom generalizes the axiom from group theory. So you have the associativity, you have a neutral element, you have the dual, here the dual generalizes the inverse, and you have this property, in fact, which is, we don't need this to be an axiom. I guess this can be deduced from the other. But anyway, it's easier to whoa, what happened? Okay, it's easier to assume this as an action, but anyway. Okay, so you have, for any element of the set, you have a specific other element corresponding to the dual, which generalizes the notion of inverse. So the main difference between group and the fusion ring here is that in a group, when you make a composition, you have only a single element. You multiply two elements of a group, you get an element of the group. But here, you multiply two elements of the finite set and you get a sum of elements. So of course, a finite group is a fusion ring, where here, you have only one coefficient, which is non-zero. Anyway, okay. So, this is fusion ring, but of course, the categorification is something much more complicated. So, as we will explain in more detail. So as I said, set corresponds to category. Here, the fusion rule corresponds to tensor product. The associativity corresponds to pentagon equation. The neutral will correspond to unit axiom, the dual to rigid category. So these three first correspond to a monoidal category. So don't worry, I will recall the definition in details of all this notion. This is just a quick overview. And the Frobenius reciprocity here. Yeah, you put the star here and then you switch these two coefficients, or you put the star here and you switch these two coefficients. This has something to do the dual of the fusion matrix. So the fusion rule can be written as a fusion matrix, and the Frobenius reciprocity corresponds to the fact that the dual of the adjoint of the fusion matrix corresponds to the fusion matrix of the dual element. So this has something to do with adjoints. So this has something to do with inner product space. So this corresponds to what we call K-linear category. We have okay. So so now let me recall briefly what is a category. Okay, so a category is a collection of objects, okay? And this object, and this collection of objects, both, none of them are set in general. So the objects here are not supposed to be set, and this collection is not supposed to be a set also. So you have a collection of objects, and then you have a collection of morphism. So you note the collection of morphism between the object X and Y is denoted like that. And one morphism can be denoted like that, an arrow between two objects. In fact, yeah, you can see, you can have the intuition of a category like a graph, a big graph. The vertex of the graph are the object, and the edge are the dimorphism. Okay, but it's, as I said, so it's like a graph. We have some extra assumption. So you can, you have the composition assumption. So you have a morphism from X to Y, from 1 to Z. Then you have the composition morphism. So you can see as a graph like that. You go there, there. Then you can go there with this morphism. You have an identity morphism between X and X. There will always a morphism denoted like that, such that when you compose by any morphism from X to Y, you compose here, you get F. And you also have the identity for Y, you compose, you get F. So it's like that, which, yeah, so it's the identity, it's okay. And you have finally the associativity. So you have X, Y, Z, T as object, F, G, H as morphism between these objects. So you can make, you have two ways to make the composition H, G, and F. You can put this parenthesis of this parenthesis. And the associativity assumption says that these two ways are the same, they are equal. Okay. Il y a quelqu'un qui a. Tu dois regarder s'il n'y a pas quelqu'un qui a. Tout est fermé. Allez, le son des autres. Okay. OK. So, for people who are not familiar with mathematical symbol, this symbol means they exist. This symbol means for all. And sometimes, if I write ST, this means as such that. OK. okay. So now let me briefly recall some basic notion of category theory. So what about an isomorphism in a category? So we have a morphism. A morphism between two objects is called an isomorphism. If there exists another object, so F is between X and Y, and another object between Y and X, such that the composition of the two ways are identities. And if so, we'll note that X and Y are isomorphic like that, with this symbol. Okay, so this is isomorphism of between two objects. So what about the notion of functor? So the notion of functor is a notion between two categories. So you have two categories. And a functor F between two categories. So you map up an object in C to an object in C prime, but also map the morphism in C to the morphism in C prime. Okay. And a functor should satisfy some properties. So we have the morphism between X and Y. This morphism transforms as a morphism between F of X and F and Y. The functor of the identity is also the identity of the F of X. And the functor is also the functor of a composition is the composition of the functor of the morphism. Okay. So in particular, if a morphism is an isomorphism, a morphism F is an isomorphism if and only if F of F is an isomorphism. Okay. Okay, so I'm sorry, I am going very quickly, but if you want to something slow, you should watch the video of last semester, or in fact, the video of two semesters before. Here we are just covering very quickly the basic notion. So what about a natural transformation between two functors? So now we have two categories, but also two functors, and we want to define a notion of transformation between these two functors. This natural transformation will be denoted like that. And it will be natural in the sense that it will satisfy some properties. In fact, in categoric theory, when you say natural, this means that it satisfies some commuting diagram. Okay, so such a transformation is given by a collection of morphisms, so denoted like that. So you put a small x in index for every object of the first category, and you get a morphism between f1 of x from f1 of x to f2 of x. So this natural transformation is given by such a collection satisfying this this commuting diagram. So you start from this object, you apply phi of x, you get here. So this is that. But as we said here also from the functor, you can go from there to there by applying this morphism. And same here and here. So you have two ways to go from f1 of x to f2 of y. And the natural transformation axiom says that these two ways are the same. In other words, the diagram commutes for all x and y object and for all morphism. This way equals this way, which is this equality. Okay. So now, natural transformation, okay. No, natural isomorphism. Naturalism is a natural transformation such that every morphism in the collection are isomorphism. Pas entendu? So a natural isomorphism is a natural transformation n'entends pas? Dis-moi quand ça arrive. C'est bon? Bon, on va pas le faire trois fois. So naturalism. So I'm sorry because we have the internet connection cut. So if I repeat several times, it's because maybe the sound was not working. So let me repeat it the third time. A natural isomorphism is a natural transformation in which every morphism in the collection are isomorphism. And then the two functors are called isomorphic and they are denoted with this symbol. Okay. So now we have a blank page, which means that we finished the first session of last semester. So this is the second session of last semester. I will read. This I already said, natural transformation, okay, natural isomorphism, okay. Okay, so now, what about category equivalence? So you have two categories, C and C prime, and the category equivalence is given by two functors, but now one functor is from C to C prime, it's the other functor, is from C prime to C. So, an equivalence of category. So, C and C prime are equivalent as a category if you have these two functors such that the composition you can compose G and F or F and G. And you can consider the identity morphism, the identity functor, sorry. And so to have an equivalence of category, you need to have a natural isomorphism between this composition of functor and the identity functor, and also this composition of functor and the identity functor of C prime. And in fact, did I define the notion of identity functor? In fact, I don't. So the identity functor is, as you can expect, the functor from C to C, F maps to F, and X maps to X, etc. Okay. So it's a bit tricky. It's not, we will see here isomorphism of category, which is easier. Here, equivalence of category, you have to be careful. This is not the same thing as isomorphism of category. You have this kind of natural isomorphism. Anyway. Okay. So this paragraph said that everything worked well with the commuting diagram and equivalence of category. Okay. And so a more intuitive, a specific equivalence of category, which is more intuitive here, is the isomorphism of category, where you don't have a natural isomorphism here and here, but you have equality. So be careful, this is in general, for equivalence of category, you don't have equality here. You just have a natural isomorphism. And you have example for which it can be equivalent, but not isomorphic. This is exactly what I am saying here. Isomorphism of category implies equivalent, but not the converse. So here is the generic counterexample. The generic counterexample deals with skeletal category. So a skeletal category is a category where if two objects are isomorphic, then they are equal. But in general, the category can be non-skeletal. if a category is not skeletal, then it is equivalent to its skeleton, where you collapse, in some sense, every isomorphic object into one. But it is equivalent, but it is not isomorphic. Okay. So what this theorem about? This theorem is about some notions which are very useful about how to characterize equivalence of category, because if you want to prove that you have an equivalence of category between two categories, it may be quite hard, but this theorem will help you. It's a characterization of equivalence of category. So a functor F, it's an equivalence of category if and only if you have these two properties: fully faithful and essentially surjective. So what fully faithful say? So the functor induces a bijection on the Ohm set. So maybe I did not here bit bijection between Ohm sets, which means that we assume the category, the Ohm set to be the collection of morphism between objects to be set, which is not true in general. This is the notion of locally small category. So maybe I forgot to read that we assume the category to be locally small here. Anyway, so the functor induces a bijection between Ohm set. So you have a Ohm set here, the Ohm set image of the functor, and this should be a bijection. So this is fully faithful. And essentially surjective means that, so for all objects in C prime, you have an object in C such that f of x is isomorphism to x prime. So which means that the functor is surjective up to isomorphism in some sense. Okay. So now we can introduce reintroduce the notion of monoidal category. So a monoidal category is given by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 component. First component C, the category. And the category is assumed localismo. So as I said, the collection of morphism between two objects is assumed to be a set, which is not true in general. So here we assume that it is localismo. The objects are not assumed to be a set, but the collection of morphism between objects are assumed to be set, localismo. Okay, so then you have this component, the tensor product. So what is that? It's a bifunctor between the die product of categories. So I did not define that, but you can define that obviously. So you have the direct product of category. It's a functor between this direct product and C, the bifunctor. In particular, you have this property, the identity of tensor product is the tensor product of identities. You have natural isomorphism encoding the associativity, the natural associativity isomorphism. So there are three functors. So C, the direct product C by C by C to C here. And so you have three objects and it maps to this product with this parenthesis, X tensor product Y, parenthesis tensor product Z. Okay, so you have this is a natural isomorphism. So you have natural isomorphism. So A is a natural isomorphism between this functor and this functor. So you have this functor, which is a functor from C cross C cross C to C, like that. And this A is a natural isomorphism between this functor and this functor. So you define this one exactly as here, but you change the parenthesis. So you have this ingredient, the natural isomorphism. Okay. Then one here is an object of C. And you have also an isomorphism, iota, one tensor one to one. And this couple, one iota, is called, in the book of Ettinghoff, Nikschich, Gellacki, Ostrich, it is called the unit object. So not just one unit object, the couple is a unit object. Okay. So you have all these ingredients. And of course, this ingredient should satisfy some axiom. So you have the pentagon axiom and the unit axiom. So the pentagon axiom is also called the associativity constraint. So this is about associativity, and the unit is about the unit object. So the pentagon axiom, so this is the most important axiom for a monoidal category. So it say it is about the, it's a constraint on this natural isomorphism. So you start from here, you have 1, 2, 3, 4 objects. And you have 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 way to make parentheses. That's why you call that pentagon, because this means five. And you can go from one way to parentheses to another using the associativity constraint. And for example, So I will not go into the details here, but you can apply associativity constraint here and here, you go here, or like that. And you go here by another way. And the Pentagon axiom say that if you go by there or by there, what you that's this commute. So this composition is equal to this composition. Same morphism. So, here, for example, you apply the associativity constraint and you move this parenthesis here, like that. And here you apply here. So here you have the identity here and you change the parenthesis here. So this isn't changed, et cetera, et cetera. So if you want to go into more details of that, you should watch last semester's video. Okay, so the unit axiom. Is saying the following. The functor of left and right tensor product by one are equivalence of categories. Auto-equivalence. Okay. And we will use this notation for the left and right functor. So here you start from X and you one tensor X on the left or on the right. Okay. Okay. So what about that? This lemma saying that this functor et là je suis haute. Oui. Sorry. So internet cut. Okay. So this lemma is saying that this so this functor in general is not the identity functor. You are in a quite general setting, but this lemma says that there is a natural isomorphism between this functor and the identity functor, and again for the same for the right one. And this natural isomorphism I denoted by small r, small r. So it's given by a collection of morphism like that. With a small index. So a collection of isomorphism between one tensor X to X and X tensor one to one. Okay. So this proposition says that this morphism is equal to this tensor product, of, again for the right one, which is not true in general. You cannot L X tensor Y is not equal to L X tensor L Y, but this is true for when you one of the two are one. Okay, so proposition here, we can prove the triangle diagram. So this was proved in semester one, 1 year ago. So the triangle diagram say that you have an ambiguity here. If you start from here, you can apply the associativity constraint and then apply the unit constraint, the unit isomorphism to go there, or you can directly apply the right unit isomorphism here to go there also. And the triangle diagram says that these two are the same. This morphism is equal to this morphism. The triangle diagram says that the ambiguity, in fact, do not exist. And this is proved here. In fact, in some, this is proved in the book we are covering, because we have this axiom in some other, in the literature, in other book. This, you don't have the unit axiom, but you have that as an axiom. So the book we are following make this choice to assume this unit axiom. In some sense, it's more natural. Okay, so this is what I am saying here. Okay, so this is the triangle diagram. Okay, here you have one here on the right and one on the left. But you have also two other possible triangle diagrams. We have one on the left, one on the left, or one on the right, one on the right. And this is the same idea. The ambiguity do not exist. You can go by there or by there. This is the same morphism. So this is mainly, I will repeat that several times during the courses. Most of the time, the axiom of a notion in category theory, the axiom are there to remove the ambiguity. So most of the time, they are commuting diagram, saying that this ambiguity, in fact, do not exist. This morphism equal to this morphism. This is here it is proved because we use the unit axiom. But some new notion, sometimes you assume, you have some assumption to remove the ambiguity. Okay. So this unit isomorphism, if you take just x equal one, you can see, you can prove that this is exactly iota. So from one tensor one to one. So okay. Okay. So this proposition says that the unit is unique in some sense, is unique up to a unit isomorphism. Okay. So I will not take too much time about that. This proposition says that what? So the set of morphism between one and one is a commutative monoid under the composition. And in fact, there is a correspondence between the tensor product of morphism and the composition of morphism with iota. Okay. So let me provide some example of monoidal category. So the easiest example is a category of sets. So the objects are sets, the morphism are function. The tensor product are the direct product of function, of direct product of a set, sorry. The unit is given by this couple, with one is the set with zero, and iota is just trivial. And the associativity is also trivial. Everything is trivial. Now, what about this category of vector space? So K is a field. The objects are vector space over the field K. The morphisms are linear function, so terms of matrix, if you prefer. So the tensor product is the tensor product of vector space. The unit is the field itself as a one-dimensional vector space. And the associativity and unit are also obvious. Okay. Now, something a bit more interesting. The category of representation of a group. So here, the objects are K vector space in which a group acts. The morphisms are K linear function as before, preserving the action of the group. And preserving the action of the group is this written here. So you can move the action outside. And the tensor product is a tensor product of vector space compatible with the action of the group in that sense also. So you can move outside. So you can, this G act on the tensor product, the same thing as you can act component wise on it. Okay. So here, vector space depend on the field, representation category depend on the field, but if there is no confusion, we will write that without writing the field most of the time. You fix a field and then we stop to write the field. Now, the category of G-graded vector space. So, you have a group. The objects are vector space which are graded by the group, so which means that they can be written, they can be decomposed like that. The morphisms are K-linear function respecting the grading. So, like that, so you have a morphism K-linear and an element, a component of the grading map to like that. And again, the tensor product is compatible with the grading like that. So if the component of this tensor product is equal to this direct sum like that, you have the component of that and the component. Oh, here is W. Let me fix that. So the component, this is this component of this component, and you, yeah, like that, x, y equal g. So this is the direction. And again, the associativity is obvious. Okay. So we will make the pause now. And after the pause, so the pause will be 5 minutes. Pause. Well, let me write that. This one. Pause. So between that and so 5 minute pause. And so after the pause, we will introduce this category as the vector space or G-graded vector space with some deformation on the associativity constraint. Wow. Okay. So now it's a pause. Okay. So let us restart. Okay. So now I will explain. So you have this category of non, j'ai plus le. Ah, bon. Ah ben c'est bon, il est revenu le truc en arrière là. So this category of G-graded vector space, as before, the associativity is trivial. But now we can define a new category when it is non-trivial. And this is this one. Same notation, but you have this non-trivial associativity here. Okay. So so you have so the object here are one-dimensional vector space for each element of the group. Okay. And the tensor product is given like that. Tensor product is given by the product of the simple objects, the product of the group. So every object, every vector space can be decomposed. It is graded, and in fact, so I did not define the notion of simple object, but I will define. You can consider the easiest way, the easiest possible object, and they are one dimensional in this case. Of course, in general. for a category of vector space, the simple ones are not one-dimensional. For example, for representation, the simple objects are not one-dimensional, but for vec G, the simple ones are one-dimensional. Okay, so I will redefine simple later. But for this example, okay, so the tensor product here is as usual. As I said, what is different will be the associativity. So here, the associativity is identity for vec G. But for vec G omega, we put a multiplicative constant here, depending on G, H, on the three elements of the group. So this is one-dimensional, this is one-dimensional. So this is just, the only way to deform that is just to make a multiplicative constant. And this multiplicative constant should, so you have a new associativity constraint, and you can see that the Pentagon equation make this satisfy this property. And in fact, this multiplicative constant, this function, is a three cocycle in the cohomology of the group. So this is one way to deform the category of G-graded vector space. And you get something non-trivial if the three cocycle is non-trivial in general. Okay, so here, this was example. All this example, in all these examples, the object was set. Here, we will provide example where the object are not set. And this is the main interest of category theory, to deal with something which are not set. So the objects here are not set, they are numbers. So of course, if you consider the set theory, you can define number as a set also. Anyway, from naive point of view, a number is not. Okay, so the objects are numbers. The tensor product is a addition of number. The unit is zero. And here the main point is the morphism. So morphism between the number 6 and the number 8. Here we display one example of morphism. So this is an example of category, monoidal category called category of tangle. And in this category, the morphism look like that. They are a tangle. And this is one example of tangle between 6 and 8. So this is like that. You put 6 dot and 8 dot here, and you connect one dot here with one dot here, like that. But it's in 3D, so it's three dimensional. So you can go, below, like that, or like that, etc. You can have some free curve here, etc., etc. So if you want to go more into the details about that, you should go to the first semester video. So you can make such, the home set are such tangle, and the tensor product here of morphism is given by such concatenation, horizontal concatenation. So you have this tangle between N1 and M1, this tangle between N2 and M2. So with these two morphisms, you make the tensor product. You just put them together. So this is obvious. And you see, you put the N1 point, the N2 point. So you get N1 plus N2, which is exactly the tensor product. This is addition here. Okay, so the identity. Huh? T'entends? The identity is you put end point, and you just put a straight line like that. This is identity. So tensor product, and the composition of morphism is the vertical concatenation. So you put a tangle here, you put a tangle here, and you can compose if M, you have the same object here, and here the same object, and then you connect the string. So you connect this string, etc. And here you have some new open string, closed string here. And at the end, you remove the intermediate plane like that. And you have one morphism here, one here, and you get the composition. So this was an example of, in some sense, non-intuitive monoidal category where the objects are not set or vector space or what you want with this tangle like that. Okay, so now what about monoidal functor? So we know what is a functor, but the functor theory need to satisfy some extra assumption. Oui. Quoi? Marche plus? Oui. Exprime-toi. Ça, tu m'entends là? So we already define the notion of functor, but for a functor between monoidal category, need to the extra assumption to get the functor between monoidal category, monoidal functor. So you have two monoidal categories given by this ingredient. The category, the tensor product, the unit, the associativity constraint, and the unit the unit morphism. And again here. And so a functor between a monoidal category is not just it's a functor between categories, but you have an extra object, J, which is a natural isomorphism. Okay. So what J is? So a natural isomorphism, as I said, is given by a collection of morphism, here a collection of isomorphism between. So this is how the functor deal with the tensor product. So the tensor product of functor of X and Y is the functor of X tensor Y. So you have this collection of isomorphism to be a functor a modular functor, and of course, this comes with some ambiguity we need to remove. And to remove this ambiguity, you have this axiom. Okay, so you have the unit axiom for a modular functor, one map to one. So you have an isomorphism between these two. You have the axiom, the associativity axiom, the monoidal structure axiom. So you see, with a monoidal functor, you have a new ambiguity. If you start from that, to go there, you can go by this way or by this way. This is always the same. You can alternatively apply the associativity constraint or the, what's the name of that? The natural isomorphism J. So you can apply that. If you combine these two natural isomorphism, you see there is an ambiguity. And so this axiom says that this all this ambiguity do not exist, that this morphism equals this morphism. So always the same. So you have to be careful. You have to go more into the details to see where is the ambiguity. You apply associativity, J. Here you apply associativity. So here, J. And the associativity under the functor. Okay. Okay. So you have a functor between two monoidal categories. And this functor can have zero or one or several monoidal structures. So yeah, J, you can call J or this J, this monoidal structure. You can have no one or one or several one. okay. So what about this theorem? So this theorem is about the unit object. So I don't want to go too much into the details also. We don't need too much to care about unit object. Here you still have an ambiguity. But this theorem said that in fact it's okay. It's not an assumption, it's a theorem. You can prove that this ambiguity do not exist. Okay, well, I don't need to go into the details about that. Okay. Here you have the same commuting diagram when you replace one by X. Every red one here you replace by X, and you have also some commuting diagram. So all this ambiguity also do not exist. okay. So as before, in the book, we define monoidal functor like that with unit axiom and monoidal structure axiom. But in the previous, before the, in the literature, you can find another way to define a monoidal functor using this commuting diagram. Here, as for the triangle, as for monoidal category and triangle axiom, here is the same thing. Here, using the unit axiom, we can prove this commuting diagram. So in the literature, you can find that as a definition. But here we have the unit axiom for monoidal functor, and so you don't need to assume that. You can prove that. Okay. So it's an alternative way to do. Okay. So all this theorem about one and unit say that in fact you need to care too much about one. In fact, you can safely identify all the ambiguity about one here. this equal this, this morphism is identity functor, etc. You can assume that everything about one you can assume to be trivial. Okay, so now, what about notion natural transformation between monoidal functors? Okay, so you have two monoidal functors. You have two monoidal categories, two monoidal functors, and a natural transformation between monoidal functors, like that. So you have a natural transformation as usual. So you have something with the one, an isomorphism between the one, so you don't need to care too much about that. And you have a commuting diagram which should remove the ambiguity due to, you have this ambiguity, and you remove the ambiguity by assuming this diagram to commute. So this is an extra assumption making a natural transformation, a transformation of monoidal functor. So this is monoidal extra assumption here. Okay. So here we provide a list of examples of monoidal functor and natural transformation between monoidal functor. Okay. Okay. So we consider a finite group, a morphism between two finite groups, and we will define two F star with the index on the top or on the bottom, like that. We will define that to be a monoidal functor between this will be between the category of representation of G and H, and this one category G of G graded vector space. So you take this morphism of group, and you have a representation of G. Then the restriction of a representation V of G. Okay. So you have F of H, it's a subgroup of G, and you can restrict the representation of G to F of H. And this provides the representation of H. And this is a way to make a representation of H from this morphism. And so you get a functor, and in fact, it's a monoidal functor between representation of H and representation G and H by restriction. Okay. And dually or similarly, you have between here you have G first and H second. Here you have G H first and G after that. So this is, in some sense, this is dual. And when it is dual, everything is reversed. So you start from a H graded vector space, and you can make a G graded vector space like that. And you use again the morphism here. So I don't go into the details. You get a new monoidal functor like that. Okay. So now if you start from, in fact, vec g is defined for a group, but in fact you can define a monoidal category for any monoid, vec s. In general, for vec s with s monoid, the identity functor is a monoidal functor, where the monoidal structure is trivial. Okay. And here we will explain that natural transformation between the trivial monoidal functor, you can have something non-trivial. So it's a big technical some sense. So you have something trivial. A monoidal functor is trivial. The identity functor is a monoidal functor, and it is easy, it is trivial. But you can define natural transformation between that, which is non-trivial. So this is easy to see. Thus, this natural transformation is completely characterized by a map between the monoid and the field. So I don't go into the details. This depends on Schur lemma. And so this map can be non-trivial. So this is a way to completely characterize this natural transformation. in this example. Okay. So monoidal functor between vec g omega, vec g1 omega 1, vec g2 omega 2. So this monoidal functor completely given by two maps. So it's a group morphism between the two groups, and the other one is a map from g1 cross g2 to the non-zero element of the field. So it's completely characterized by these two maps. So you have this monoidal functor like that, and the monoidal structure is given by this multiplicative constant. And the monoidal structure axiom is given by this, so the by this equality between this. So it's okay. So you can define. So you have this monoidal functor defined like that, and you can define natural transformation between two such monoidal functors. Okay. So what about that? So this is a bit technical. Maybe I will skip that. Yeah, anyway. So it's too technical. I have no time to read that. Okay. So here there is an example. So anyway, I'll skip that. If you are interested in that, you can read that. Okay. So now. So what about action of group on a category? So you take a category. You can define for any category, you can define a monoidal category called hot C, where the objects are equivalence of category between C and itself. The morphisms are natural isomorphism between this equivalence of category. And the monoidal structure, the tensor product, is given by the composition. So this is monoidal category. In fact, it's a monoidal subcategory of ANC where you relax here, it's not equivalence, but any functor. Here it's not natural isomorphism, but natural transformation, still composition. So ANC is also a monoidal category, and OC is a monoidal subcategory of ANC. Okay, and you can consider. So if C is a if C itself is a monoidal category, you can define also that the monoidal category of monoidal equivalence. Here you have an equivalence, but C here is not assumed to be monoidal. But if C is assumed monoidal, you can assume the equivalence to be monoidal too, and you have this new example and denoted like that, which is a subcategory of this one when C is a monoidal category. Okay. So take a group. We can define the category 4G. So in some sense, this is a skeleton. This is a skeleton of that. The objects are elements, just element of G, not vector space, not G gradient vector space, but just element. Yeah. Not exactly the skeleton, but yeah, anyway. So element of G as a composition, so the morphism between two objects is the identity if they are equal or otherwise it's empty, there is no morphism. And the monoidal structure is given by the composition of the group. So why we define this category? Because we will use this category to define the notion of action of a group on a category and on a monoidal category. In fact, the action of a group G on a category will be a monoidal functor between 4G defined here and odd C defined before. Here. Odd C here. So you an action of group, the group G to this category is just a monoidal functor like that. And if C is monoidal, the action on a monoidal category is a monoidal functor. And here you take up, you take this one. Okay. So the monoidal structure here for T is given by that. Here the composition is exactly the tensor product as we said here. The composition is a tensor product. And okay. Okay, so now we define what is, or we recall what is the action of a group on a category or on a monoidal category. So again, I repeat again that I am going very quickly because I am just recovering what I said last semester. Of course, when I will do new material, I will go much more slowly. Slower. Here I go very quickly because I have no time to. For people who did not attend the previous semester, I need to recall the basis. But again, if you want more details, you should watch the video of last semester. Okay. So G equivariantization of a category. I denoted like that. Okay, so you have a category denoted like that. So this new category is defined by this object. So X is an object of the category, and U is a family of isomorphism. So here you need to use the action of G, this monoidal functor. So it's given by the family of isomorphism between this object and this object, such that this ambiguity is removed. So this diagram commutes. Okay. So you have the object. The morphism between two such objects are given. So you have morphism between X and Y, such that the diagram code again. Okay. So here we define a G equivalentization for C category, but if you want to define a G equivalentization for a monoideal category, you have again to use a T, this T here, with this category. And okay, and so you define this new monoideal category. So if you take the category, the trivial category VEC, then the G equivalentization of VEC is rep G. So this this notion is non-trivial. You start from a trivial category, and then you can define a non-trivial category. Is it a G equivalentization? Okay. Okay. So so the category C is called strict if the associativity and the unit constraint are trivial. So you have the this equal to this. In general, they are not equal. You have associativity isomorphism, but then you have here you have an equality and also same for the unit, and the associativity, even if it is equal, you can still have a non-trivial associativity constraint. You can but here you assume also this to be trivial. For example, when we talk about VEC, VEC G omega, we have this equality here, but here this was not identity. So for the strict case, this should be identity. So here are examples of strict monoidal categories. So the category of all the functor between, so you take any category C, assume locally small maybe, and the category on C we already defined before. So all the functor between C and C, the natural transformation between the functor to be the morphism, and the tensor product given by composition, this monoidal category is strict. And in fact, this is very useful because this strict category is used to prove MacLane's strictness theorem. Okay. A second example of strict monoidal category is the category of set. Of this not the category of set, but the strict version of the category of set. In fact, is a category of set in which you put a bar like that. Of course, the category of set itself is not strict because you can have two sets of same cardinal, two different sets of same cardinal, and so it's not strict. It's not anyway. No, I am confusing strict and I'm confusing two notions: strict and the other notion. I forgot the other notion where two isomorphic objects are the same, but anyway. So this category, the objects here are non-negative integer. The morphism are the map between these two sets. So you can see this morphism as any map, any function like that. And the composition, the tensor product is given by the multiplication. Okay. So if you have a morphism, you can compose, you can make the tensor product of morphism. So between the multiplication of the number. And so the how do you compose like that? You compose as follows. So here you this is a function from a set of M1 times M2 elements, and you go to a set of N1 times N2 elements, and this is a way to compose, to make the tensor product. So this set, this category is strict and is monoidally equivalent to the usual monoidal category set when you take only finite sets. They are not isomorphic, but they are monoidally equivalent. Okay. So now, what about same idea? You replace set by vector space. So the same idea, so the objects are non-negative integer, the morphism are linear function, so your matrix, and here the composition of morphism are given by what is called the Kronecker product of matrix. So it's a well-known notion, Kronecker product. So it generalizes, in fact, this formula, but for a matrix. Again, this is denoted, we put a bar like that, and this is monoidally equivalent to the usual one. Okay. You can do the same thing for G-graded vector space. So here you have to be careful about that, but okay, more or less the same thing. So as you can see through this example, most of the usual monoidal category we consider are non-strict, but monoidally equivalent to strict. So explain here. They are all strict here, and they are all monoidal equivalent to the usual one, most of them. So in fact, this observation is true in general. This is called MacLane strictness theorem. So any monoidal category is monoidally equivalent to a strict monoidal category. So let me recall that means that this is monoidally equivalent to a monoidal category where the associativity and unit constraint are trivial. Fini à quelle heure? En 5 minutes? So this was proved in the first semester. This is the idea of the proof. I will not go into the details here. The idea said that you can understand the proof. You can understand the proof at the level of monoid. But I will not read that, I will skip that. So this was proved in the part one of the course. Okay. So so this theorem is non-trivial in the sense that So a monoideal category is always monoideally equivalent to a strict one, but not always isomorphic. Not always isomorphic. So if you take C to be a non-strict, if C is non-strict, then it is not isomorphic to its strictification. In fact, if you call that a strictification, so MacLane's strictness theorem says that you always have a strictification in some sense. But if C is non-strict, it is monoidally equivalent to strictification, but not isomorphic. So you can say, okay, what's the point of considering non-strict category? The point is that the process of strictification adds a lot of objects, and this is not always usual. In fact, most of the time, it's not usual to the strict. Sometimes it's usual, sometimes it's not. Okay. So let me. So for the last few minutes, let me explain why. Or maybe I will skip that also. Here, this explains what about the strictification. So you consider this example. We know that in this example, the associativity isomorphism is not trivial because of this three-co-cycle. When this three-co-cycle is non-trivial, and in fact, okay, you can make the strictification of that, but this had a lot of morphism, and this is related to some free group. So I will not go into the details of that, but this had many new morphism, as many as you have objects in some free group, and you say, you know, the free group, you can make the Kelly graph like that, you have some fractal, a lot of objects. So this had the strictification here had a lot of objects, and it's not that convenient in some cases to consider the strictification of that. But in some other case, it can be. But the cost of that is very, very large. Okay. So the opposite process of strictification is, in some sense, not the opposite in details formally, but intuitively, it's called the skeleton. And the skeleton is what I said before, I confused with strictification. The skeleton is when you collapse all the isomorphic object into one. So a category is skeletal if there's only one object in each isomorphism class. So any monoidal category is monoidally equivalent to a skeletal monoidal category. It's called the skeleton. So it's like for MacLane strictness theorem, but not for strict, but for skeletal. And this is also very useful. You can say, okay, this is good to have only one object for isomorphism class of object. Two objects are isomorphism, then they are equal. This is also very useful. But the point here is that you cannot have both. You cannot have both skeletal and strict in general. You cannot make, if you take the skeleton of a strictification, it's no more strict. And if you take the strictification of a skeleton, it's no more skeletal, etc., etc. So we'll stop here. So we will restart from here. So see you from here. Let me write that here. Next time, I will write here. See you next. So I write that. Next time, I will restart from here. So next time we will continue like that up to the end of these slides. And then we will start new material. So I in one day I took, I did 50 pages. So there are something like 200 pages. So I will need maybe four or five sessions to make this all this recovering. So it's going quite quickly. Four or five sessions. Okay, so we stop here and see you next Monday. So if you have questions, you can ask on the WeChat group. I will put the slide up to here in the WeChat group, and the video will be in the WeChat group. So ask questions. So see you next time.